Hey there, welcome to Play Noggin. I'm Julian, your brain's player too. Our pokey little channel has been chugging along for over a year now, and about once per video, someone will leave a comment asking why we haven't covered one of the hottest games out there. With every passing week, it seems people get more and more angry that we just will not even mention this game, trying to point out to us our obvious blind spot. Why won't you do this video, they demand, crying to the digital heavens, thinking their pleas fall on deaf ears. Well, fear not, my friends, for today is the day we finally talk about Overwatch. I mean, aside from our very first episode ever where we talked about Tracer's time travel. But I don't mind talking about Overwatch again if you don't, and there have been plenty of new characters and updates since the game's launch to keep it fresh and rife with scientific angles to explore. The character I'd like to dive into today is one of the original 21, but recently Jeff Kaplan and the people at Blizzard decided she needed a dramatic overhaul. So they took a normally timid Swiss miss who spent most of her time hiding from battle until the moment was right, and turned her into the right hand of God, zipping around the battlefield granting life to fallen teammates almost at will. Her name is Angela Ziegler, but you can call her Mercy. That reworked revive mechanic fascinates me. Changing it from one big ultimate to a standard ability that works one person at a time not only changes how the character is played, but changes how we think about resuscitation. There was a time when it seemed special, but now Mercy makes it look so easy. I have to wonder, what are your actual chances of coming back from the dead? Your odds of resurrection depend on several factors, like what killed you. Obviously, getting shocked into cardiac arrest by Winston leaves your body much more intact than getting blown to bits by Junkrat. So let's assume your body is in good shape apart from being dead. In that case, your chances of survival are greatly affected by whether or not someone is around to start pulling you away from the light immediately. If you're out in the woods and have a heart attack when no one is around, your odds of living are pretty low. Without your heart supplying blood to your brain cells starve for oxygen and begin to die after 4 to 6 minutes. After 10 minutes without blood flow, your brain will be so damaged that there's no point trying to revive you. In a case like this, getting immediate cardiopulmonary resuscitation, or CPR, can mean the difference between life and death. In case you haven't taken a CPR course, and you really should, CPR provides a little bit of oxygen to the brain by manually compressing the chest and forcing blood through the heart. Older techniques famously also involved mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, but it was found that just doing chest compressions at a rate of 100 beats per minute was just as effective. So, good news for everybody out there who gets squeamish about putting their lips on a stranger's mouth. Now you don't have to get hung up on boundary issues when a person is literally dying. But CPR doesn't work as well as pop culture would have you believe. On TV, it saves people 75% of the time, while in real life, that number is probably closer to 5%. That's a pretty bleak prognosis. If Mercy's revive worked one time out of 20, nobody would play her. But in real life, saving one life out of 20 is a heck of a lot better than saving no lives out of 20. So keep on doing those chest compressions. I mean it, keep going, because if you started providing CPR right away, you might be there for a while. As long as there's a chance that the brain cells are functional, you should keep going. It can take as long as 20 or 30 or even 45 minutes to revive someone. Their brain could survive even longer if the person's body temperature dropped below 35 degrees Celsius and their heart stopped from hypothermia. In those situations, they're not dead until they're warm and dead. So if you want to maximize your chance for revival, try and get killed by May. CPR isn't the only trick in the bag medics have when trying to revive someone. You're probably familiar with defibrillators, those metal paddles TV doctors use to shock someone's heart back to life after they've flatlined, usually while screaming, "Live, damn you, live!" A defibrillator can make all the difference when used correctly, but Dr. TV usually gets it wrong. There's more than one way a heart can stop pumping blood to the brain, and when someone's flatlining, that's the exact wrong time to use a defibrillator. A flatlining heart is asystolic, meaning there's no electrical activity in the heart telling it to pump. That happens when nerve cells in the heart have no electrical potential, and there's no difference in charge inside and outside the cells. So shocking the heart doesn't get anything moving again. All you're really doing in that situation is cooking the heart. Defibrillators work when there is still electrical activity in the heart, but no blood is flowing because the heart is beating out of rhythm, a condition called ventricular fibrillation. Defibrillators can also be used when the lower part of a person's heart is beating so fast it doesn't fill up with blood before trying to pump it along. That's what's known as ventricular tachycardia. In these cases, a defibrillator works by forcing all the electrolytes out of the heart's nerve cells and letting them re-enter naturally. In fact, for a few seconds after the shock, a patient's heart will be asystolic. So you can think of using a defibrillator sort of like turning the heart off and then turning it back on again. Medics can also use drugs like adrenaline to try and get your heart back in working order. Or if your heart's wiring is working but the muscles aren't contracting, medics have to figure out why and solve the problem. Some of these treatments, like high blood acidity, can be solved in minutes, while fixing things like hypothermia can be more time-consuming. Luckily though, hypothermia might give your brain a better chance at survival, and doctors have been experimenting with replacing lost blood with ice-cold saline to cool the body down and buy the brain more time. Still, your odds of coming back from the dead are pretty slim, unless you're a hero. Heroes never die. Whether or not Mercy is OP since Blizzard reworked her is a topic of debate, but if she were a real-life medic, her success rate would be nothing short of miraculous. There's no one else I'd rather have watching over me. Hey, thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Overwatch has 23 more heroes that we haven't talked about, and they're adding more all the time. So if there's one you think we should cover, let us know in the comments. If you want to learn more about Tracer's powers, check out our very first episode right here. And don't forget to keep on playing. According to Blizzard, Tracer's powers are possible because she can speed up or reverse time. Put another way, she can move in the fourth dimension however she likes. But are these abilities possible according to our understanding of the universe? Could you bend time to teleport or even travel backwards in the fourth dimension?